ready for the Mind Doctor Magnificent Show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. Still looking a little purple in the background there. Things have not been technically right since I had my computers blow up about a week ago. Still working on getting things corrected here. I appreciate your patience. It's not like it's too terribly purple back there, but some of the things are still a little bit up in the air since we had the great computer crash that caused a couple of shows to be off the air. We're glad to be back now and running the shows, but still a little bit troubled about the studio lighting and the webcam setups and all that kind of stuff that make this stuff possible. I appreciate your patience as we work through rebuilding our studio here. Today we're going to have another episode of Meet the Author, and we're going to talk about children's books, which we haven't had too many children's books authors on. I'm trying to struggle here with a lot of things, including my ridiculous glasses. I'm going to change my glasses. How about that? Anyway, we're going to talk about children's books today. An interesting thing for us, because generally, you know me, we've had a lot of romance novelists, mystery novelists, very few nonfiction authors. Children's books has been the rarity, so we're going to talk about that today and what goes into that and why, and all the special challenges that go with being an adult writing for children. Getting into the mindset of children, what makes children really, what engages them, what holds their interest. It's an interesting topic for me, and I hopefully it will be for you today. Today's show is brought to you by, and this has nothing to do with children whatsoever. Today's show is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform that helps you get the best credit lines guaranteed. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit score to see how much you can get. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You heard me correctly. Let's say start. If you don't have a business yet, but you got a solid business plan, then that doesn't mean just a whim or an idea. I got an idea for a business. No, that won't cut it. You need to have a solid business plan, sit down with an accountant and a marketing director and a business plan, all that kind of stuff, all the ducks in a row, and they can help you get funding, get the best funding you can qualify for. The strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, bridge loans, all that kind of stuff. They work with real estate, startups, as I mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really, really simple. You just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Minddog, right there. apply.fundwise.com/minddog. I'm in a little bit of a silly mood today. The link is in the description, and I do appreciate you patronizing our sponsors. Now, on to the big program. Mary Elizabeth Jackson is an award-winning author of the children's book series Poohlicious. I hope I'm saying that right. Tuscany Bay Books. With the third book coming out, I believe now, in July of 2021, I believe it's out now. It's called Oh, the Wonder of Me, Cheers from Heaven, a mid-grade reader release with co-writer Thornton Cline. Mary Elizabeth Jackson focuses on writing empowering books for kids and is working on an 8-book series with Cline for children, as well as books for the special needs community and a motivational book for adults. Jackson is also a ghostwriter and book collaborator, and I believe she has a series, a television, online television series dedicated to authors and the craft of writing. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Mary Elizabeth Jackson to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Mary Elizabeth, welcome. Can I just call you Mary?
Absolutely. Yes. You know what? It's funny because when I was looking, you know, going to do the author name and everything, there were Mary Jacksons, but no Mary Elizabeth Jackson. So I said, all right, that's what I'm doing, because you don't want to be, you know, all the way down at the bottom of the list for people to find you. So,
you know, one of my biggest, and I complain about a lot of things. I think I'm a natural born complainer, but one of my biggest complaints about doing this job is people with names that are hard to pronounce. Now, your name is not hard to pronounce, but I bet you there's a phone book full of Mary Jacksons.
Absolutely. I know. So I was trying to make things easier. I could have gone with M period E period Jackson to do one of those author things that people do, right. You know, but I did not. So.
Well, there's a thing. Three names makes you a very important person. One name makes you a super important person. If you just were Mary and everybody knew who they were talking about, that would mean you were, like, you know, on the Cher, Madonna, and Jesus and Gandhi level. One name. Anyway, enough with the names.
Takes a lot to get to a place like that. So, and there are a lot of Marys in the world. It's a very common name.
Right. A lot of Marys in my family and a lot of Elizabeths in my family.
And ours too.
My wife is Elizabeth. Anyways, so much for the name game. Silly way to start the program. Do I have it right? Do you do I don't want to call it a podcast. It's a internet television show.
Yeah, it's live streaming, just like what we're doing here. And we go live every Tuesday. Central time is 10:30 to 11 a.m. And we started streaming recently on Amazon Live, but we also stream on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and YouTube.
Right.
We're getting ready to have our 3-year anniversary coming up, actually the middle of this month. So we're super excited about that, because we started obviously in 2017. A friend of mine and I wanted to do a live stream show, and I was newly published February 2017. And I said, you know, let's provide a platform for authors that's free, because there's no author out there that don't want to talk about their book. And so let's provide that platform for them, but also provide information and resources and things for everything about writing. So we've interviewed authors all over the world, from debut to New York Times bestsellers, international, national bestsellers, bestsellers, award winners, you know, all kinds of, they're just from every walk of life. So it's been really fascinating. And I love, you know, we just had Terry Shepherd on this morning. So he's just an amazing guy.
I talked to Terry. He's a really cool guy and a great musician as well as an author. I don't know if you touched on any of that stuff. Yeah.
No, but I've had a lot of times. He and I have the same publicist, so we've had communication, and he's got a children's book out now. So we've had those conversations together. And so I know about the music, but this morning we focused on his children's series that he has.
I did not know he was writing children's stuff as well. Interesting.
Yes, he is on the third book, and it's come from the pandemic, and it's really interesting. He has a video that goes with it. So he actually played the video for us this morning, which was wonderful. But he is trying to have the pharmaceutical companies are interested in using his books and the video for education for children, because each book focuses on something. You know, I think the latest one's all about vaccines. So he did do all the research, and he did get in touch with the medical association to get that legit, correct information for children. So, I think what he's doing is really amazing. And the fact that he has got that connection, and that the pharmaceuticals like Moderna and Pfizer are interested in what he's doing in his book is really amazing. So.
That's super interesting, and I would love to even have that conversation with anybody. And I don't want to go there today about the whole this, because I feel like there's a double-edged sword there. I agree that it's great to be able to educate children in that kind of way, and I'm glad that somebody with some money is behind it. But when I hear the pharmaceutical companies, I just think about, you know, it's so much dirty money there that it's kind of a weird gotcha for me. Like, yeah, I would do that, but there'd have to be some stipulations on where the moral ground would be and exactly, you know. It's like taking money from the mob in some ways when I dealing with pharmaceutical companies. But interesting stuff to me. Do you what really motivates you and inspires you to write for children?
Well, part of it comes from my son. He is, you know, a lot of the inspiration is from him and the situation that we had with him. I am also a special needs and disabilities advocate here in where I live, and an ambassador advocate for Autism Tennessee. So I had him very, very late in life, and there were some problems, and there were problems near the end for him and for me as well. And the first book was really born out of that period of time of recovery that he survived and I survived. So it literally was kind of, I jokingly say I birthed a child and a book series, because that's sort of what happened. I had twins, you know? And in that recovery time is where the first book came. And so my son is level one autism. He has sensory processing and language processing. And, you know, he is an amazing child. And I'm an advocate for early intervention for children and those early services that really can make a huge difference in a child's life, from them not being able to do things to actually conquering a whole lot and being able to be a more fully functioning person in the world and the best version of themselves they can be. And that's really what we want for all children that have challenges. And all of us have challenges, right? I mean, nobody comes in this world perfect. So the premise behind these books really is, in the word Poohlicious, it is a play on words. I love Dr. Seuss. Kids love funny words. You can teach them. They learn in rhyme. They learn from funny words. You get their attention more. It's on their level, you know, being silly and funny. And so that allows them to be more relaxed in an environment, and they're going to learn more that way. But the word Poohlicious really is a play on words, and it means the embodiment of the innocence of childhood. So when I looked at my son, that's the word I heard, because as a creative person and a writer, you know, a lot of times we have those downloads of things that come, ideas and inspiration. And for me, I am at my heart, I'm a poet. I love to write poetry. I've done that my whole life. So children's books is not something I really saw in my life until it just happened one day. And it really did just happen like that. It was this story that came, and I sat on it for about 2 years because I didn't know if I should do anything with it. And then I went to someone and talked to them. They introduced me to Thornton Cline, who he wrote there are 10 original songs in the back of the first book that he wrote them. And they're like lullabies. They're very sweet. My daughter's recorded the songs. They're on Amazon and iTunes. You can get them. And he and I wrote the second and third book together. And then we have another one coming out in October. And that's a middle grade reader, Cheers from Heaven, you mentioned in my bio. And that's more for kids ages 8 to 12. This series here starts with little tiny ones, you know, and then it goes to toddler. And then this goes into elementary school. And it's about accepting who you are, no matter how you came into this world, because you're not broken, even though the world thinks you're broken. And so it's very important for us to teach our children that if you came in with some kind of disability, you're still okay. You're still okay. And one of the most important things in the world for a child is to know they are okay, even if somebody down the street says they're not, or somebody at church, or somebody in their school, or one of their peers. You know, that's their opinion and that's their problem, because really, you know, you're designed the way you are when you come into this world. And each book has I am statements in there. I'm a big believer in starting that language out really young in children and helping them to feel empowered early on. So in the third book that just came out June 2nd, Oh, the Wonder of Me, that one is all about the quirky, weird awkwardness of being a child at that age, like 4 to 8, and the silliness of it as well. I really think it's important to write from the viewpoint of a child so that you can talk to them in their own language, because then they learn and they're going to be more engaged than if we talk down to them. You know, that's just not, books are not, shouldn't be designed that way. But in the third book, I spend some time in the back of that book explaining how I've used affirmations in my life, how empowering I feel that they are. I have taught my children, and then I've written some in there for adults to start that conversation with their children and use them for themselves as well. So, early understanding of processing of emotions, I think is so, so important.
Me too. And thank you for doing that. And I understand that you had a personal something to gain in doing that for your own, but it's still a great thing that you're doing. I want to challenge you a little bit.
Okay. Uh-oh, all right.
It's not in a bad way, because I agree that you want to make everybody feel okay, but I think better than okay. I have a high functioning autism, and
okay, you do yourself?
Yes.
All right, awesome.
And I also volunteer a lot, do a lot of stuff with different groups, and I performed at a school that was only for autistic children and children with Down syndrome. And I'm going to start crying now like a big sissy.
That's okay. It's okay. I'll probably cry with you.
Yeah. I was playing a song that I wrote called Nobody Else Is Like Me. And the whole idea behind that is you're not okay. You're not okay. You're better than okay. You're gifted. Everybody has a special gift and something to celebrate. And it's really a very simple song. It's very, dumbed down for children, make it easy melody to remember and for children to really grasp onto. By the time I got to the end of the song, the entire class was just hugging me, and we were in like a group hug, and I was crying in front of everybody. But the whole idea behind this is that, and I appreciate you wanting to make people feel secure, and I get all that, but I think at some point we need to kind of acknowledge that you're more than okay. You're special and gifted, and you bring something unique and really, in my opinion, everybody is a genius. Everybody has some kind of seed of genius in them and something special that they can add to the world. And I think that is a very positive message and something that I try to talk about. So, the idea that we're okay is a great message that, you're not less than anybody else is what we want to say. But it's even more than that. You have something special and unique to offer the world that nobody else does. And I think that's the message I think that they really need to hear or want to hear.
Well, and I talk about that too. So saying that you're okay is kind of like where you would come from in talking in the conversation of a little child, maybe one that's very, very little. But it's also easy language. If you want to go deeper, what you're talking about, I believe every child, we all have superpowers. I mean, whatever that is that your child is able to do is his superpower, her superpower. Also, when our kids come in like this, it challenges us as the parent, caregiver, adult we have to stretch ourselves. We also have to learn and educate ourselves how to help our child be the best they can be in this life, so they understand what's going on with them and understand how to overcome whatever that is that they're facing. Because you can't just be, you can't just not parent. You can't just sit back. It makes you step up to the challenge in life, and it makes you grow. And the most empowering thing you can do is educate yourself. And of course, like your child, family members, whoever else is in the life of you and your child, but to help your child see the importance of who they are, why they're made the way they are. They're made for specific reasons. All of us are. And like you said, we're all better than just okay. We do have those powers and strengths inside us. And so that's one of the next books I have coming out is all about that, about kids, superheroes, how we all have a superhero inside of us.
Right. Do you feel like we're making, and I know that's kind of like a very broad question, but when you look at our society today, do you think we're making any progress in this area?
I think some ways we are. I think so much has happened in our world, not just with the pandemic, but with so many issues being brought to light. I believe that we have areas and places where, yes, more awareness is happening. Kids are not going to all of a sudden start coming into the world and they're like a cookie cutter, just like a certain way and there's no issues, that's not going to keep happening. So we as a society and world have to grow and change with what's happening and in our children that are coming in, because they're our future. So we've got to prepare them and get them ready. I would say locally, what, you know, when you are, if this is part of your life, one of the best things you can do is become an advocate and advocate for this out into the real world and in your community. And I'll give you an example. So I partnered with our local library here, and what we've done, a conversation that started back last year, you know, has turned into the library sensory friendly now. We've created an area of resources for families to come in if they are looking for services for a child or someone in their family or someone they know. You know, that information, that material is there that's available for them to find answers, hopefully, or lead them to something that might find answers for them. And then we have just opened a sensory room. Like last Wednesday, we just cut the ribbon with the mayor and the chamber president and the board of directors for the library. And so we have a sensory room for children now at the library, because we want all children to feel welcome to come. And so that's gotten a lot of, I would say, press and attention. And so for my community where I live, we have a lot of advocates here. And so I think those conversations, we just have to keep having them, you know, don't you think? We have to keep having them. We have to keep educating people. You know, I have another show that I do that's special needs TV. And part of that is to provide that information and resources and interviews. And I have a doctor that I want to interview. And so he can talk about all the data and research that he's done, you know, that just will give people more information and really, these platforms that we have, technology is just fantastic this way that we can reach people all over the world. You know,
I agree with you that it's great that we can reach. I don't feel like I have any influence on anything. I mean, the more I do this and the more, you know, I make myself feel good about the conversations we're bringing to light and getting some exposure to ideas like this. But then I look around, I feel really frustrated. It came up the other day in basically a very different conversation that a guy who was, his name was Forrest Rivers, who's an environmentalist, which is kind of funny.
That is a funny name. I love it though. He sounds like an actor, you know?
Yeah. Forrest Rivers. I said, yeah, wow, your parents must have had a really great sense of humor. Yeah. But we were talking about, you know, my whole thing is the divisiveness that we have, where we can't even have conversations about things that matter without turning really ugly. And I just tried to use whatever influence I thought I might have to get people to turn off people that want to think for you. Ideas on television, cable TV, news is really divisive. But just get away from that and start critically thinking for yourself. And I haven't seen any, and even in my listenership and the people who write to me and in the chat rooms and all that stuff, it doesn't feel like I'm making a dent. And that, it feels really frustrating. Do you feel like you're making progress with sharing this information? And not just sharing it, but that it's resonating and people are not just wordplay saying, yes, we agree with you, but demonstrating that they actually get it.
You know, that's really tough. And you've hit on a really important subject, and your feelings about it are very validated, because it's true. I mean, you feel like you make some headway and maybe you've touched one person or two people or five people, and that's better than nothing. But right. There are those times you feel like, okay, you're banging your head against the wall. I mean, I began, and this will relate to what you're talking about. I began a journey in 2010. My world was changed forever in 2008, 2009 with my middle daughter, because I have three kids and two of them were nonverbals. Okay. And so there was something that happened in the years 2008, 2009 to my middle daughter that set me on a different path as an advocate and slash mama bear. Okay. And I began in 2010 on a journey of trying to get cameras in classrooms to protect children. Now that has been an uphill battle, that the mountain, you can't ever reach the top. And I've actually just recently sent an email trying to get that conversation started. Can we get this on the agenda for next year to even be considered to talk about? We have 5 states now in the United States who do have legislation and bills for cameras in classrooms. I do think that cameras need to be there. As a parent of a nonverbal child, it is absolutely terrifying to let that child go out into the world and someone take care of your child for you. Right. And you talk about helicopter parenting, and psychologists and therapists, you know, really are very, there's the negative talk about being that kind of parent, but you put yourself in the shoes of a child who cannot tell you what's happening to them and tell me that you would do something differently than being more of a type of helicopter parent, because this is your child. And so I, unfortunately, my daughter and our family have had the experience of someone abusing our child in a public school setting. Okay. It's not something I talk about very often, but it is the truth. And it went on for 8 months because my child could not explain to me what was happening at that time. So when I tell you these things happen and why they're ever allowed to happen ever, I do not understand. And when you're a person who has that ability to affect law, to change law, to write law, why would you not stand up for something like that?
Right. Well,
that's what I don't understand.
I think a lot of people like me, I applaud what you do, and I wish I had more power. We get frustrated. I think part of, and not, this isn't for everybody who doesn't get involved and try to make the world better, a better place in any way. But I think a lot of us just feel really frustrated that anything we try is basically, we feel powerless. Right. Powerless to make a change, powerless to have any influence on things that the whole world should recognize are problems we need to solve. But we end up, for one reason or another, just letting ideologies, whatever it is, get in the way of having constructive conversations about things and then taking action. And, you know, anytime you talk about any kind of legislation, there's going to be opposition. There's got, whatever it is, even if it's the noblest cause in your mind and you know you're doing the right thing, there's going to be a line of people waiting to resist you and stop it. And so we feel powerless on that. Well,
I felt so powerless. I had to walk away for a couple of years, because when you are trying to do the right thing and you're trying to do something in the name of justice and you know it's right, to have people who stand in the way of that and don't, and a lot of times it's the dollar sign, you know, but yet our country throws away money like there's no tomorrow. I mean, just throws it away. And then we have those in our country who have so much money. I mean, put it to use for things like this. You know, let's correct these wrongs that have happened. Let's make, you know, people don't think we're the greatest country in the world anymore, but if we have the ability to affect so many things and change so much, like you said, why can't we go in that direction of righting these wrongs or making the world a better place for everyone? Because, you know, we're not going to separate people. We're not going to, okay, so all of you who have this going on, you're going to go live in Australia. And all of you who have this going on, you're going over to Africa. You know, that's not going to happen. It was not intended that way, or that's how it would be in this world.
Right.
Just like we'd have one spice, it'd be salt or pepper, right? Or maybe cumin or turmeric, but it's not like that. And it's not meant to be that way. And, you know, I love that my children have come into this world with the challenges that they've come into this world with, because it's taught them compassion. And if they are in class with a child who has more challenges than them, they're going to learn compassion. They're going to learn compassion for that child, we hope, right? And compassion for other children. Now, that whole myth of my child can't play with your child because they might catch something from your child, that is something that still exists, which I think is, I don't even have words for how unrealistic. I just don't understand that mentality. Because having a disability is not a disease that's infectious, like what we've had going on, you know? Yeah. So, I never knew that this would be my life. My children have kind of carved that path out for me. And I hope that I can do something in the name of them that they will be, you know, proud of, that will have some positive effect on the world. You know, the library here, my 8-year-old son and I, the first Tuesday of every month. He wasn't with me today to do it, but we've gone in and we do these live videos now with our local library, and we do either a craft or a science project experiment that's easy enough for any child to do. And we try to use things that are at home that, you know, you don't necessarily have to go out and buy, but you could get them easily if you need. But they're easy for all children to do, because children, you know, we learn from 9 different avenues in our life, and for a child, all that tactile stuff and all the feeling and the sensory and the visuals and everything help them learn. If they can't learn one way, they can absolutely learn a different way. You just kind of put all that together. But, you know, things like that are, I think we need more of things like that for kids, right. You know, but having my son there, it shows other children what he's doing. Okay, I can do that too. You know, or I want to do that as well. And so, you know, we've been through he's been in OT and speech therapy since he was 18 months old, and he's 8 and he's still going strong in those, in that world. And I commend therapists, because they really can make such a great difference in a child's life. But, you know, my grandmother, she was a religious woman. She would take my mother and put her in the car. And on Sundays, she would drive into the poor areas of where she lived. And she would go into different homes. And the men who were drunk, she would go in there and she would make a pot of coffee and feed them breakfast and drag them to church. She was a butt kicker, my little tiny granny was. And so I just love that about her. And my mom grew up, she would stay in the car, because this would have been back in the 1940s and 50s. And my grandmother would keep her in the car. She would go in and do this. But my mother would see all that, she understood what was going on. And then when I was a child, my mother went back to work when I was about 9. And she went into the college system right as the laws were coming around for IDEA and the disability laws were coming into play. So she ended up working in a college system in Orlando at Valencia. And it was called the handicap department at that time. That's the language that was used. And she was able to write all these grants for programs. My mother didn't know what she was doing, right? She got in there, saw these needs, started working. And she got all this money and grants written for programs for all her students. And actually, those programs are used around the world now. But I had no idea that would have any effect, or even I would, you know, it would be part of my life, you know, like carrying that on. And I think we have to teach our children, whether they have challenges or not, service work and having a service minded heart and volunteer work and loving something outside yourself and finding something that you care about that's important to help others.
Wow. Great, yeah. Great stuff. Now you touched on a couple of things that I want to kind of expand on there.
Okay.
The idea of, first of all, that your mother was influenced at a very young age by seeing her mother's behavior. But also this idea that parents feel like, I don't want my children playing with a Down syndrome child. I don't want my child playing with an autistic child. They might catch it. I think it's really important, and I'm not an expert in this. I'm not a psychologist. I don't have a degree in education or any of this stuff. But I think from a human perspective, I really feel like it's important to socialize and treat people who have quote unquote special needs or a condition that we have in the past have looked down upon, treat them like they're part of the family, part of the group, and have friends that are like that. And I know it sounds trivial, but I have a friend who's a comedian, and he talks about this stuff because people react to the language, the R word that he uses, but he right away he uses it with the intent to get people to react and say, oh really, you care about those people so much, are they with you tonight, how come you didn't take them out with you tonight, how come they're not part of your circle, how come they're not part of your world, how come you don't take them to social gatherings with you? And I think that's important for children. So you'd mentioned, I don't want my kid playing with them because I don't want them to catch it. It's so important for quote unquote normal children to play and socialize with autistic and Down syndrome children and people with all sorts of disabilities, to kind of accept them and let them, first of all, feel like they're wanted normal part of society, just one another person, which is what they really want to feel deep inside, that I'm not an outcast. I'm not different. I'm not so different that you can't be like me or be with me. That right. part of it. And then so I think that it's healthy for the people who aren't affected by a condition as it is for the people who have that condition. You agree?
Absolutely. 100%. I mean, it taught, so my two oldest have had children that have, you know, were either fully autistic or nonverbal or something in their classrooms when they were young. So it taught them to have that understanding and compassion, and it taught them to be helpful. You know, the teacher took turns having the children help whatever child it was that needed help. And kids like to feel important, but it's also important for a child. Okay, so my little guy, like, he didn't even understand how you put Legos together, right? And we take for granted a child's going to understand how to put a toy together. He didn't know how. So he had to be taught how to do something so they can be in classes. And that's the purpose of having the integration of the, you know, children that are typicals and non-typicals by society's verbiage in the classrooms together, so that they can, you know, they can see, oh, okay, so this is what I do with a Lego. Now they can be creative and do whatever they want, but the intention behind it is maybe to stack it, you know, and because my little guy would just place it on top. He didn't understand you have to push in order to put it together. So even those basic, simple things, having those children together, they can learn from each other. A child who's scared on the playground can watch other children and go, okay, so I climb the stairs and I go down the slide and that child's having fun. So I'm going to overcome my fears and my worries and my proprioception issues and my sensory issues and things, because that child's doing what I want to do. That is going to help encourage a child that has issues and challenges to be able to do that. We have two really wonderful parks here, and they were both created for children with challenges. So even a child in a wheelchair can get on and swing or spin right. or do whatever it is that child wants to do. I think children need to be exposed to each other for many, many reasons. They're teachers to each other.
Right. And I think we need to encourage that more rather than, you know, but there is that fear. Now, that fear also, I'm talking about the parents of quote unquote normal children there. They fear that, oh, I don't want my kids catching that, which is so ridiculous. I think fear and misunderstanding and ignorance can create a whole other problem. And I'm not sure how much you get into this, but the idea of parents and families can be torn apart. But because everybody has the expectation that they're going to give birth to a quote unquote normal healthy baby, and then these they find out that in some cases that's not always guaranteed in life, mm-hmm. and then it can tear families apart. Blame, insecurities. I hate to say this, sometimes not up to the challenges of. Of being a parent of a child with special needs, all those things can tear families apart or rip apart the family dynamic. Do you discuss any of that stuff and its effect on those children as well?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, because it all goes together. You know what I mean? Divorce rate is much higher in families with children with challenges. And I mean, you know, we did not know what the expectation, we had no idea. My pregnancy was completely normal. I had intrauterine growth restriction, which happens in under 200,000 cases in the United States a year. And so it was perfect until week 31, as a pregnancy goes at an older age, because I was 45 when I had him. It was not a planned pregnancy, so I call him, he's my OMG baby, my sweet, you know, he's our puzzle piece. He totally brings our family together. But he stopped growing, and they had prepared us for much worse than what ended up happening. He's just a true miracle. But I have friends who have children who will never leave the home. Who are, you know, these children, they're runners. These are violent children. You know, the Facebook groups that I'm in and parents that I know, there's desperation that they feel sometimes and a loss. And every day is a struggle to get through. And it's really sad because they do tend to feel more alone. And these are parents and family members. They're not going out to restaurants and the nail salon or whatever, hanging out with girlfriends or even family nights together. You know, they don't get to do this kind of stuff. It can be a very isolated place to be, and a very lonely place to be, especially if you're facing, you're facing a diagnosis with your child and you have no idea what that even means. It's like speaking a whole different language. And so that's why I say education is such a huge, huge part of all this, is to go and advocate yourself. Once you get over that initial fear or shock or not even understanding what's happening with your child, then educate yourself, because then you're more empowered when you know what's really going on. And then when you can see the things that might be used to help that child, that's just going to only, it can't do anything else but empower you, right?
Well, you would hope.
You would really hope. But yeah, I mean, you know, we had that ribbon cutting last week, and just touching on what you're talking about, one of the directors for Autism Tennessee, she was going to come to the ribbon cutting for the sensory room. And she messaged me and said, you know, I can't come because I can't get a babysitter for my daughter. And her daughter is older, but she still requires care, you know, right, full-time care when mom's not there. So the stress is probably an understatement, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Out of all the families, and I know many families with children of special needs, only one managed to stay together. And I thought that was a real, real tragedy. But I understand the stresses that can cause that. Too often, though, it's in my opinion, and it's very sad to say this, but too often it's blame. It comes into one parent blaming the other for this situation. I want to ask you about something that is probably of a higher calling than either of you or you or I can kind of talk about. But it's on my mind because of a political column I read this morning where it's all about why so many people believe in conspiracy theories and lies and stuff like that. And it started out by saying we are told lies from birth, and big lies all our lives. Our parents feed us with lies. But one of the ones it pointed out, which I thought was really curious, is that people believe that everything happens for a reason. We're taught that, and there's something good and something to be learned, and some reason this situation happened in our lives. I don't want to say to us, it happened in our lives, and we need to react to it, adjust to it, learn from it, grow with it. I think that's an important thing, but the author was kind of saying that is a bold lie. It's not necessary. It's totally untrue, which I kind of, I at a gut level, it hurt me to hear that. And even though I suspect that he might be onto something there, I do feel like all the things that happen to us in our lives are meant to help us grow. And I think the people who let that pull their family apart don't necessarily buy into that. So I think even if that is a lie, it's a healthy lie in a lot of ways. See, where do you fall on that idea of everything happens for a reason?
Well, I'm a believer of it, because I feel like if it wasn't meant to happen, it wouldn't happen. I mean, isn't life full of lessons, right? And
yeah,
I mean, otherwise you're not going to grow. If the world was very easy and our lives were really easy, and listen, I had to learn this. I've been on a long spiritual journey in my life, and it's helped me be able to get through what I've been through with my family and my children. And it's helped me to understand and help my family be strong. We're strong. I mean, the challenges that we have faced have only made us stronger as a family. And it makes you, first of all, I think you should own your crap. I do. I know I'm going to use the word crap on here. Okay. Own your crap, and you need to take responsibility for yourself, your actions, your thoughts, your feelings, and be respectful and responsible. But if you need to grow and change to be a better person or a better you, you know, like if you're stuck back here, but growing is going to make you your life so much better. I think that you need to, I feel like that's important to do, because then you're just going to be a better version of yourself and show up that way for everyone else in your life. But I feel like that, I mean, and if you are, you know, Jesus's mother, Mary, taught him in stories all through his life. He taught in parables to teach lessons to people. If we don't learn, we don't grow, and we just stay in one place. And then what would the world be like if none of us grow? I mean, unfortunately, we have countries and places still on this planet that if a child is born with disabilities or some sort of challenge, that child is either, you know, dispersed of, or they're put in a back room so that nobody ever sees them because it's an embarrassment. It's a shame. It's a, and it's treated, I guess, a lot like leprosy used to be treated, you know?
Yeah, really. Do I have that picture anywhere? No, I don't. I play with a band for 20 years now, the same band I've been playing with for actually 21 years now. And one of the guys, we used to take, and I use the word kid, he's a severely autistic young man. And only a few years younger than me, but still looks like a child. But we take him to every gig that we've played for about 10 years. We used to bust him out of the home that he's in, and bring him out and hang out with him just to have some kind of normalcy in his life. But it was frowned upon by the people who were in charge of taking care of him. When they found out where we were taking him to bars and stuff, but you know, he wasn't getting involved in bad things. He was just enjoying the band and socializing with people and dancing and being treated like a normal person would want to be treated, you know, just a regular guy. People didn't look at him, oh, Jason's autistic. They just looked at, oh, Jason's part of the band. He's part of their entourage. And so I thought that was a good thing, but the people in charge of taking care of him did not agree with that and don't want him going out. Now, I think that's a big problem for us, is that a lot of the people who are in charge of and charged with the care of people who have these conditions later in life don't recognize that real need for them to feel human and normal and part of everybody's life and not different. Even though they have special needs, they're not different. They shouldn't be treated as somebody who can't go out and have fun with adults his own age, even though he doesn't look their own age and can't do math problems and can't write an essay on the same level they can. That doesn't mean he shouldn't be able to enjoy the same life that they have. Can I get your take on that? Well, do you think we were doing the wrong thing by him?
By taking him out?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so at all. I mean, I can understand them being upset if they thought he was getting drunk and, you know, getting into some kind of trouble and mischief. Yeah, I can understand them being upset.
He did get drunk once in 10 years, I have to admit. He did get drunk once in 10 years, but he regretted it. And I think that was a lesson he learned on himself, that he would never let that happen again.
Well, he probably thought it was like in SpongeBob, because my kids are theater kids. My girls, and we just got done with SpongeBob the musical, which is really funny. But you know, there's the song "The Best Day Ever." That probably was his song in his head while he was out with you guys. But you know, I think where the caregivers are at is that stigma still of it's right or wrong. There's that judgment there, and our society still does that. If you come into the world and a limb is shorter than the other limb, or your face looks a little different, or you can't walk or you can't talk, it's judged as wrong. And it's not wrong. It just is what it is. Right. It just is. So how do we work around this? What can we do? How can we teach this person? I mean, my middle daughter, I told you, was nonverbal. So I was like, okay, how am I going to teach her alphabet? Because she can't say the words. She would talk like this. That's how my daughter talked. And we thought it was cute. Oh, it's fairy language, you know? And she could say, okay, and mommy, that was about it, right? And this is before I knew anything, right? So we were like, oh, that's kind of cute. She has her own language, you know? And we thought she'll grow out of it. But I didn't realize how far behind she was and that she was developmentally delayed because I could see some genius in what she was doing, you know? But I taught her how to sound the words out phonetically, and that's how she learned her alphabet. She would sound them out. So we found a way around it.
Wow.
You know, you know, when a person has a stroke, I know I've read research about how they'll teach them to sing what they need because it overrides a part of the brain. The brain is brilliant and children are brilliant and their resilience is brilliant. And so we as a society have to learn to accept that and see the beauty that is within each human being because everyone has a light and everyone has their own brilliance.
Right.
You know,
and talk to me about the challenges that you face in writing these books, though, because you're not autistic, and so I know you have your personal
not that I know of. I've not been tested, so,
okay. So but you've had your personal experience with it. But writing the book for people who have autism, does that pose any unique challenges for your thinking about the words you choose and the storylines you choose and all that stuff? Does it affect the way it has to affect you, the way you write? Right?
Absolutely. It guides all of it because one of the beauties of being an author is being able to be an empath, to be able to immerse yourself into that world, that human, that character, that whatever is happening. So because my world is centered around being an advocate and trying to make things better or find solutions and offer resources, and I'm living with this in my home, I get to experience that life in that world every day. So I get to see what works and what helps or doesn't help. I mean, I'm not perfect at any of this, but I've taken my own experiences and research and things that I personally think are important too, to add into all of that, to be able to write about things that are helpful or engaging or educational. You know, because even a child who is nonverbal still needs to understand social skills, right?
Right.
So we have to teach them that. I'm working on an 8-book series. It's with an organization out in California, and we've not gotten past the first book yet and had it illustrated or anything, but it's the keys of excellence. And so the first one I'm writing about is integrity. Well, integrity is even challenging to teach a typical kid. So how do you talk about integrity to a child who's nonverbal or they have a low IQ? So you have to be creative in learning what to do and how to be able to engage and communicate with somebody on that, you know? Yeah. So all of those things come into play. And I try to go into that place of what does it feel like to be a child? You know, where is the child's understanding? What makes them tick? What makes them who they are? You know, that wonder of that age is just, I think it's way more fun than the grown-up world. The grown-up world is way too serious.
I agree, but it's hard for me to get back into that mindset, which, and to be honest, I think we've had one other author of children's books on here, but they weren't really focused on children with special needs. And so to write for children, I don't think I would be able to do it. And I've been writing my whole life for adults, even when I was a kid. So it would be a real challenge for me to write for any child, because I just it's hard for me to get back into just that experience of wondering how a child experiences the world, whether special needs or not. It would seem to be a challenge for an adult. It just to be able to write. You know, sometimes it's hard enough to have a conversation with the child. Never mind write for them specifically.
I think it's because I have a son, you know, he's 8 years old now. And, you know, there's been 8 years of being in that world, immersed in learning and helping and growing. And so I guess that's why it's easy for me at this time. Now, if I decided 20 years from now to try to do this, I don't know that it would have the same effect or even be close to the same. You know what I mean?
Right.
So
is it fair to say that this was not when you were young? I mean, really young, high school and aspirational college, whatever, those years where you're kind of looking at your life and thinking how it's going to turn out and what you wanted to do with your life. Is it fair to say that this was not part of the plan?
It's very fair to say. I had no clue. No clue at all. I had no clue. I would have children that had disabilities. I mean, when I got married in 93, I was told I couldn't have children. So we didn't have kids for 7 years. And wow. So my children are miracles, all three of them. And I did lose one, but all three of my kids are complete miracles. So that to me changes a lot. It changes things for me. My job as a mother and a parent is different. And I take it seriously. It is my job, right? And being an author and an entrepreneur and, you know, a live streamer and an advocate, all of those are very important to me. But no, I loved psychology and I loved, I was a dancer from the time I was 3 until about 24. I grew up in Orlando. My first job, I danced at Disney World. That was the direction I was going. Singing, dancing, acting, film, TV. That's where I was going.
Wow. My first job was at Disney World too. And it was just open when I, my
first job. In Orlando, what did you do there?
I worked in the magic shop, doing magic tricks to help sell magic tricks that they sold in the magic shop.
That is so exciting. Oh my gosh.
Oh, you have no idea how exciting. That's a whole other story.
Yeah.
I'm responsible for the FBI raiding Disney World. Thank you. but the reason I asked about your life plan, I think the reason so many families break up or are extremely stressed about this, whenever anything happens, it's out of the plan you had for yourself. Like, well, how dare God throw me this curveball? Right. This is not what I had planned for my life. And so adjusting to that, now I have to look at my life and the purpose of my life becomes caring for this child that is really needs more attention than most other children are going to need. And that wasn't part of my plan. My plan was to have children, but still have this career over here that I had my mind set on, my heart set on. It was the design of my life, and life threw me a curveball, and I can't adjust to that. I think that's a big part of the problem. I think the self-realization of that, I think, is something that people who are parents of children with special needs really need to come to a hard, but they need to find some way to be grateful for it and experience that, okay, this wasn't what I planned, but again, that lie that we tell ourselves, whether it's, and I happen to believe it's true, that everything happens for a reason. There is a gift in this that if you realize it, that you're probably less likely to break up, less likely to have a marriage fall apart, family fall apart, and more likely to have a happy life and a child whose life is not just marred by their challenges, but a happy, fulfilling, and prosperous life, even overcoming those challenges. Just get your comment on that aspect of it. Of, oh, well, this isn't what I planned on for my life. Is a big part of the reason that adults have a hard time coping with the challenge, the curveball that life has thrown them.
Oh yeah, I mean, I had a curveball thrown to me in my mid 20s, I guess, and it changed the trajectory. That's one of those tough words. It changed it forever for me. And I went through a long time. This is before I had children, but I went through a long time of being bitter and angry and not understanding. And, you know, one of the most empowering things that we can do is, what is our purpose in this that's happening? You're a child comes into your life and, you know, you are faced with, okay, so we have this child that is coming into our world that is going to need all this care and help in maybe little ways, maybe many ways. It doesn't matter. Raising a baby, period, is not for the faint of heart. Okay. And then you throw in challenges. So you're upping your game there. There's a thing about resiliency and finding what the blessings are in it. It's really hard to see those sometimes. Sometimes people can't find a blessing anywhere at all. But where is your power in this? Where do you have control? Where do you fit? What is your purpose here? One of the greatest gifts we ever have in life is to be able to raise a child. And I say that with compassion for the people who cannot have children. But they may be able to take care of someone else's child, or maybe they have a niece or a nephew they can help with, or they end up adopting. The being in that place of nurturing a human being into the world to help them grow up to be able to give to the world and not take away is a very powerful place to be.
Right. And I share your empathy with people who can't have children, but I think that's also another curveball that you have to just kind of like, well, oh, you, it might have been part of your plan to have children, but it's not part of God's plan for you if that's what, if you believe in God or whatever, the universe, it's not life's plan. So that there are other ways you can adjust to that and still have a parental relationship, adoption or through teaching or whatever, and that's just another curveball that I think we have to just, and I know that's a really tough lesson to say, wow, this this sucked that this happened to me,
right.
and reframe that now, wow, this happened to me, now what can I do with it and how can I grow with it and how can I learn from it? It's a really hard lesson for all of us to learn at any age.
But that makes you tougher and it makes you stronger. It does. And builds those blocks up inside of you that make you who you are, right. Because it's easy to quit. Quitting is super easy, right?
Right.
So accepting the challenge and finding out, now listen, there are days that are awful. Cry yourself to sleep, sucking your thumb in the closet. I want to jump off the roof. It's, you know, I mean, we have those days, all of us do, but then when we can come back down to ground zero and can go, okay, let's pick this thing apart. Let's look at this. How can we work together as a team? How can we work together as a family? Because having my little guy later in life, the whole family's had to help raise him. I mean, I've included everyone. This is not just going to be mama's job. We're all doing this together. And so we have, you know, and it may take you a while to get there, but one of the best ways to get out of that place of we feel sorry for ourselves or we're sad or we're depressed, we're angry, we're bitter is, okay, I have felt that. Now, where is my power? Where is my power? Where is my power? Where is my purpose? And what is my responsibility? It changes everything. Changes everything, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, I hope we kind of made a difference, and some people will take this and take something positive out of this conversation. Again, I feel kind of I'm at a very low point with my feeling of powerlessness on this kind of situation, but that's the intent here, and I'm glad we had this conversation. Now, I have just your website scrolling across the bottom, but in the description, and by the way, for the people on the audio side, it's just maryejackson.com. In the description, there are many, many links to all your Facebook pages, Twitter page, LinkedIn page. You got a lot of different pages out there. Do I have it correct that the book is out now? The third in the series, the Poohlicious, the third book, is it out now? It's called Oh, the Wonder of Me.
Yes, it's on Amazon and Barnes & Noble, anywhere that books are sold. Yes, you can get it there. And I think there's a link even on my website if somebody, you know.
Well, it's not on Amazon yet because I looked on Amazon. They have the first two books and they didn't have Amazon. They didn't have the third book on Amazon yet. I will look for that.
It's there. It's supposed to be there. You want me to look it up real quick? Because it's supposed to be there.
I was just there a second ago, but I'll go again. The link is in the description, whether it's there or not, but I couldn't find it there. I just saw two books on there.
Well, you know that. Okay, hold on. Let me pull it up. That is, no, there it is.
Okay. Well, maybe I did something wrong. Maybe I went to your author page.
Amazon is really weird sometimes because I love Amazon. We do our show live from there, but sometimes you'll go and it's not there. And I don't know, but yeah, it's there right now. And I know the spelling is also very important. So that Poohlicious word. So
you want to hold up the book? Do you, did you get a copy
of
the book?
Yeah. I sure do. Yep. I have a copy right here.
Nice cover. Did you do the cover work?
No, actually my illustrator did. And it looks like the butterflies are all glittery. How cute is that?
I think that's green screen function.
I know. That's so cool. The great effect there. I love it. Yeah. Like she did the cover for all three of my books, and that's my son on those. Like, this is one of my very favorites because that's the first one. And it won the Gold Maxy Gold Literary Award, the Maxy Award, 3 months after this one came out. So,
wow.
Yeah. Right. And it's so cool because the award has the child in a wheelchair. So it meant a lot to me to have that award. Yeah. So, but you know, we're going to keep going, and there's more books to write and then there is time in the day because, you know, there's inspiration for me at this point in my life. There's inspiration everywhere, especially having him being around children. You know, I mean, he can just, I don't know. Every day I look at him, I go, oh, there's a book. There's a story, you know?
Well, good for you. I mean, a lot of people struggle with that just as authors. Yeah, and I that's one of the questions I generally ask is like, how do you keep the fresh ideas and stories coming? But for you, it doesn't seem that doesn't seem like a challenge at all.
Not for children. Now, if you asked me to write a 50,000 word novel, I would probably start crying because, you know, this is to me a lot easier. Now, I have written an adult with Thornton Cline. We've written an adult. We wrote it during the pandemic, and it's not published yet. And hopefully it'll come out next year. But it is about following up, you know, what, you know, in life, we have to follow up with every single thing in order to have success or to move forward. So, you know, I'm kind of trying to move up into that adult to have a variety. I think, you know, for me, if I'm stuck, like right now I'm working on a ghostwriting project, but if I'm stuck, I'd go out in nature. I'd get away from everything and relax. Cause you know, we get too much up here in our heads. And,
I am struggling with that right now with a lot of projects that I'm dealing with. And, I tried that solution. I think that makes me just adds to my anxiety the way when I walk away from something and because I can't get it out of my mind. So I'm thinking, well, now I'm wasting time by walking away from it. I got to get back.
I know.
That's so hard for me.
it's like devil's advocate, man. Yeah, I know.
And my wife just told me that this morning she thinks I need to take a vacation for a couple of days. And I said, I can't do it.
Yeah. I'm incapable. I know. I know. But sometimes we do have to walk away and give our brain a chance to relax. But you know, I want to encourage you to just keep going, keep talking about it, keep sharing. I mean, the only way to get up the mountain is to keep climbing, right? It's the only way to reach the top. And if we are able to help one person, that's better than helping nobody at all.
No, and I agree. I do. Appreciate the I don't know what the effect of that domino effect, I guess is what it's called. If you can get through to one person and they can get through to another person, and then it becomes a chain reaction type of thing. It's just at some point when you don't feel like you're even getting through to that one person, it just makes you want to give up. And I'm not a defeatist like that. I won't linger in that place. But for the last, I'd say for the last month or so, I felt like we're having a lot of really cool, deep conversations. But am I only doing this for myself? And not that that would be a terrible thing, too, that I learn something and gain something spiritually from having these conversations. But my higher goal is to have some influence in the world and to kind of leave the world a better place than I came into. And if I don't feel like that's happening, I get really, really defeated and down. Like, what am I? Who am I kidding? I'm gonna do this just for myself. Right. It really becomes a challenge. And we have a good listenership. I mean, my numbers are growing. I just don't see. I don't see the action that follows the words, and people will say, wow, that was a great conversation. Thank you for that. I'm like, well, how is you put it into action? How have you really changed the world? And I challenge people today. This is my challenge now. Go out and do something for somebody with special needs. And I don't mean necessarily volunteer for an organization. You know, somebody who has got some special needs in their life, hang out with them. Treat them like your brother or sister. Treat them like your best friend. And I think we can make a big difference. And if one person proves to me that they've followed up on that, I will feel like a champion. Like I did something really worthwhile in life.
Well, you know, and the other thing is, these kids have never ending, unlimited ability for compassion and love. They have a lot to teach us. And it's absolutely amazing. So, you know what? I got to tell you something funny. So in one of the middle schools we have here, John Panera is from New York. And do you know him? I don't know that you know John Panera?
Yeah.
Okay. You guys, I could close my eyes and I feel like I'm talking to him right now because you guys sound so much alike. And he's one of my favorite people. And actually, I just went into the studio. He actually recorded the third book for me. We did it in his studio.
Wow.
So yeah, because he lives about 10 minutes from my house, and he's just absolutely amazing. And did you see his announcement that he's going to be taking over a leg of a label in Nashville?
Yeah. Well, good for him.
I know, if that's what he wants to do, right? But then, you know, but I think he'll do a great job at it. He's a super guy. So
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. I wish you great success, and we are a little over time, but I'm happy with that. Please, you know, consider coming back whenever, if you have new books to talk about, or just to, you know, have more conversation about this stuff, because I think it's really important to continue having these conversations. And again, you know, if we touch one person, and maybe they'll touch the next person and carry it down the line, but can't give up the cause no matter how difficult it seems sometimes.
Not at all. Yeah. So let's do it again. Let's come back on and just keep having these conversations, because that's a big part of it, is having those conversations. It keeps going.
Absolutely. I appreciate your time here. I wish you great success, and thank you for today.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate being here and this opportunity.
Bye for now. Be well.
Bye.
Mary Elizabeth Jackson, folks. The book is called, and the series is called, the Poohlicious series. I didn't even ask her about, I know she talked about, she said, it's a silly name for kids, but whether there had been any, because my initial reaction was thinking about Winnie the Pooh, and I wonder if there was any initial reaction from the folks at Disney about just that word, but that is really really small potatoes in the conversation. I'm glad we had the conversation we did, but I hope you got something out of that. I hope you'll check the books out, and again, if you have children with special needs in your life, adults with special needs in your life, you know, please take the first step, take some action on this. It's more than just words. That's my final thought on today. Tonight I have tonight at 8 p.m., another episode of Meet the Author, but it's also a Meet the Comedian. Steve Sabo, who is a very successful comedian, has written a book on stand-up comedy. It's called How to Fail at Stand-Up Comedy. It's about avoiding the pitfalls of what is a really, really hard profession to get into. I don't think most people know that stand-up comics and people who are comedians don't get paid for a long, long time. And when I say don't get paid, I mean they don't get paid at all. And you start out, you actually have to pay to perform. So it's a really, really difficult profession. So that's 8 p.m. tonight. Steve Sabo, How to Fail at Stand-Up Comedy, book I should have probably read 30 years ago. So until then, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for joining me. Have a great rest of your day, and bye for now.